Frank Strozier on alto sax with Cloudy and Cool. Billy Wallace on piano, Bill Lee on bass, and Vernell Fournier on drums. This is from Strozier's 1960 album, Cool, Calm, and Collected. And it's a kind of inside joke. We're nothing like cool, calm, and collected, are we? The way things are going, everything is in a state of flux, and it seems as if it's a grand design to keep us totally off kilter. We're constantly trying to steady ourselves, but we should remain cool, calm, and collected. This is Lead Stories. I'm Yatrice Lead. And of course, it's Free Your Mind Friday. This is our open forum. We gather once a week on Friday, and people say what's on their minds. And you're free to disagree, you're free to take them on, but we're always mindful of our manners, and we always take the high road. All right. 888-874-4888 is the number to call and to get things started. Looking to hear from you what your analysis is or what your opinion is of the current state of affairs. In so many places, there are stories still to be told, and want to know what you're thinking. What's resonating with you? And in what way is it resonating with you? 888-874-4888. All righty. So that's our charge today on Free Your Mind Friday. It is a strong belief of mine that we must make room, and we must always make room for popular opinion. And that is a way of helping us gauge our effectiveness in what we're doing. Jay from New York, you start us off today.
Yes, good afternoon, Utrice. How are you feeling and how are you doing?
Okay, thank you, and thank you. I'm fine.
Hello?
I'm hanging in there.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
I'm hearing you.
Hello?
Yes, Jay, I'm hearing you.
Okay, how are you doing and how are you feeling?
I'm fine, thank you. Thanks for asking, and thanks for your good thoughts. What have you to say today?
Listen, Yatrice, I was just calling up about the fires here in California and the
Oh.
tragedy, it seems, of so many lives and the communities and things of that nature. I'm just wondering, how do you rebuild a place of that nature? And how do you do it just based on the simple fact of all of the damage that has been done? Does it now become a place where there isn't the trees and things of that nature, more or less a desert type setting like Nevada and Las Vegas? Or does it rebuild itself with the beautiful sceneries and things of that nature? I mean,
Well,
what now happens, I wonder?
rebuilding is far, far away from now. The first thing that I think that needs to happen is that experts need to come in and compile in their spheres of influence reports about what they think is happening here. These are not just fires. These are indications of serious erosion of our quality of life.
I
You
agree.
know, it reflects. So we have to have that studied. This can't happen within even the next 10 years. It has to
Well,
be studied carefully, and then, because we just think that they're fires. We haven't understood yet the impact on the ecology, the impact on animal life, the impact on the whole ecosystem out there. That's a long range task. It's not going to be done, and it shouldn't be done right away. It should not be rushed. The fires have already taken their toll and continue to take their toll. And by the way, there are three fires, not just one. There are three of them, all happening at the same time.
But you know, the dangerous thing is that these things in this administration are not talked about. They don't believe in climate control or anything in regards to the earth and the changing of the earth. You know, and that's what I have the most fear, that they won't do the necessary studies to make sure that if they do rebuild, it will be rebuilt in a better way.
The fires are telling us something. What is that something? And it is telling us these things in various ways. We need desperately to have experts come in, teams of experts come in, and even from the international community, because what has happened in California is certainly linked to other ecosystem assaults and devastation. Like right now, Haiti is less than 1% now of its forest. Less than 1%. So we're seeing globally people experiencing this kind of loss in different ways. This would be a great opportunity to have people come in, those who study this, who devote their lives to studying this, to tell us what happened here and to suggest what needs to be done. The rebuilding is not the problem, and we shouldn't rush to rebuild.
Well, you know,
it's already done.
It's going to be real interesting to hear what Harvey has to say about this, because I know Harvey's the type of person that has very good ideas and very good solutions on the direction that we should go. And lastly, this. Let's look and see what's going to happen over the next couple of weeks in regards to your favorite party, Utrice, the Democratic Party, if they're going to allow Pelosi to be the head and Clyburn and Maxine and the rest of them to hold the seats that they're entitled to. My prediction is that there's going to be a fight and allowing the Clyburns and the Maxines to hold their seats, I think.
Yeah, but what is missing from the fight is we see the disconnect between those who are fighting for positions of leadership and the party as a whole, the disconnect between them and the people. This is a really fascinating development.
Because there's no direction.
We're reading about how they are vying for positions, and that's great. It's long overdue, but there are some internal questions here that the party has not addressed, let alone resolved. Thanks, Jay, for getting us started today. From New York, Mookie, you're on the air.
Utrice, I'm so happy to be conversing now with one of the most beautiful minds in the media world.
Oh, I fooled you.
Well, maybe that's only because
I'm about that.
I'm a relatively new listener, so maybe that's the edge you have. I thank the Creator every day for your existence.
Well, thank you so much.
Something I've been wanting to say, some months back, I heard two separate reports, both on PRN, that the president, Mr. Trump, drinks, well, one report was 12 cans, and the other report was 15 cans of Diet Cola per day. Now, I'm not as large a person as the president, but I don't know if I'd be feeling too good or thinking too straight if I drank that much aspartame, 12 to 15 cans, 12-ounce cans of Diet Cola per day.
It's Diet Coke, actually. Not just Diet Cola, but Diet Coke.
Well, I didn't want to, I didn't know if I could mention the brand. And they may have changed the formula a little bit, but I'm pretty sure it's still aspartame. That's the nastiest stuff. I think that was Rumsfeld's baby, his big contribution to the health of the world. So that's all I got to say is how, I don't know how he's feeling, but how well could he be functioning and thinking on that much aspartame per day?
Well, that tells you something, doesn't it, about where this president's state of mind is. I mean, it gives you an idea. If he is willing to do that much damage to himself, he doesn't really consider very much the impact of what he's doing on the other people of this country. Well, thanks, Mookie, for calling in. Thank you. Jay from Queens, you're on the air.
I'm so fortunate to be the third person to get on. And no, I'm not the Jay from New York. I'm the Jay from Queens. I didn't make that distinction.
That's right.
And it's been a minute, Jay, since we've last spoken. But first to the last caller's comment. And how are you, by the way? You said well.
So I'm okay.
I'll pass all the salutations. But the last caller, no, it's not. That's just a symptom of a deeper neurosis in the president. His Coca-Cola drink is the least of his problem. Our problem is his neuroses of narcissistic behavior and all the other deep psychosis he's got going on. And to the statement and comments by Jay of New York, I would say this. California was a desert land, if I recall correctly, geographically. It is pretty much an artificial construct in certain segments. It has been rich agriculture, but because we know the water problem that was discussed so many times on Progressive Radio and other shows, they talk about the ecology of the nation, particularly where the water shortage was in the southern part, and it was for making sure that the crops were provided for those to the planters and the agricultural farmers in the north part of California. But that being said, as you say, I'm not so concerned about the immediate redevelopment because a lot of the homes and the wealth of California being a very wealthy state, none of those people will be able to rebuild, hopefully. But when I heard over 600 people are missing, that's tragic on top of tragedy. And adding to the fact that, this is clearly a process of global warming, a trend that we're continually see. To me, it ties in to immediate what's been publicly out there in the press late about the move of Amazon to New York City. And I recall just this week, if not last week, an article in the Business Insider, which mentioned the fact that Amazon's principles and Jeff Bezos' judgment about locating on the waterfront in Long Island City, when they incited in their own article that by 2030, you're talking about the place could be on the water. And so for them to at least call into question as to the decision, not so much on the public charity and the subsidy welfare that the corporation is getting, but more on the matter of just the fact that they decided to locate there, purely on a business judgment, says that they, at least in the business community, it's being somewhat discussed as a matter of discretion economically. And I think the question of California and areas that are facing such not droughts, that these climate shifts are as much as important as it is the Brazilian dictatorship emergence and his push for development and the latest so-called elected official of Brazil. But also all of these not sporadic but increasingly flare-ups of global shift, climate change and warming. It's radically upon us. How forgetting the clown in the White House, what we do and how we think about this is very important. And tying that to the whole industry part, that Americans are increasingly, you know, buying SUVs, that's a big thing, and yet that's not the most energy efficient way to go in terms of even the vehicle consumption. It suggests that we're not tying our own patterns, our behavioral patterns and consumer patterns to that. That being said, that's what I wanted to jump off with, but I want to add one more comment on monopolizing the conversation. If you want to jump in on anything I just said, please do, because I'm going to take it one more step, which I'd like to talk about, which is the Internet of Things in relationship to the, not only the erosion of our privacy. And I happened to catch 60 Minutes, but I observed something early on where I was on the Internet and I was doing some research and came across a site that literally took public information that all citizens may have, that it's, quote, collected by the government and metadata. But also, as you know, Google's a big proponent of this and user of it to sell our information. But it takes that information and takes it to another level by putting a characterization on not the quality of the information, but on the person itself, almost like giving the person a character score as opposed to a FICO score. You with me so far?
Yes. It's getting frightening all over. Let me talk about one good saving grace, I think, in the fires in California, and that is, in the mix is Governor Jerry Brown, who mm-hmm. has a reputation of being very much an environmentalist, and hopefully he can take a different or lead a different approach to how this matter is treated. We are way, far, far away from a solution. We are way, far, far away from understanding what happened and what is happening. And this is a perfect example and a perfect time to try and understand what is happening to our environment. So there should be no rush. What has happened has already happened. We just need to slow down and study this thing in order to decide what's the next way forward. With regard to privacy rights and the erosion of privacy rights, it's going to continue. It's going to get more intense. For example, right now, there are these people implanting, companies implanting chips in their employees. There are all kinds of ways in which they're ramping up the power of the state to control everybody and control everything, to know everything about everybody.
Absolutely.
I don't know.
But I just want to add to that. It's also the point that we're giving up our privacy for convenience, just as we did under the Patriot Act for the sake of safety, gave it to the government. We're giving it to these mega corporations that are out of control. And I have to tell you, from Amazon to Google, that's what made so important what was broadcast on 60 Minutes this past Sunday, which was to talk about how Europeans are taking back their privacy and demanding that there be laws which protect that. Americans is a wild, wild west, and because of our drive and our captured politics by the ruling oligarchy, there isn't much of an effort on the public sphere by our proponents in the government to push this thing, and certainly no leadership in the White House. There wasn't under Barack on this issue, and there isn't under this clown in the White House now. But the fact is that as a nation, and in terms of what citizenship means, which is very questionable these days, to examine this and say, are we getting a dialogue? Are we having a discussion about what this means when we surrender our civil liberties, our rights to the market? And there's no one who's, I hear, leading that talk to a few local politicians, and they don't grasp it. And the legal community Some of them aren't, you know, as sophisticated. And some of them, listen, it's a buck. They're not going to challenge Google when that's their, you know, that's a big potential client for them. So I don't know where it's going to be, other than a grassroots movement for people to say, listen, enough is enough. Because what I saw is very frightening. It's like me going into the public bureau and asking for your birth certificate. Who the hell am I to ask for your information? And beyond that, going beyond that, collecting this information, you say, you know, based on this person's health record, they had an abortion. That makes them bad character. I mean,
it's going to get even worse. It's going to get even worse because it is not just about knowing. It is about knowledge having great marketability. And that means money.
It's monetized.
You know, that's what. So people are going to be under even greater pressure to give up more and more information about themselves. And they really, I agree with you there, they really have to consider. I mean, I was just at a Panera store or shop, whatever it is, about 3 weeks ago, and the person, you know, asked me if I wanted, gave me a card, a Panera card, and suggested I should register because you could get some discounts on whatever it is. So I went on the site, and the only thing they didn't ask me was, what's my shoe size, and how many teeth I have. And, you know,
that's right.
It's because I want a discount on a sandwich? You must be crazy. But thanks a lot. You put before us today a very important consideration, and we ought to be on the alert about it because it's happening in insidious ways, the collection of information that people are not entitled to. You know, you just want to buy, an item. That's it. That should be the end of it. They have the item, you want to buy it, end of story. But no, they're now pushing for more and more of information to get profiles of you. Or even if you go online and you can't read a story until you fill out a kind of a survey. So my opinion is keep your story. I'll find another way. Thanks so much for your call today, Ed. Thank you. Julie, you're next.
Hello, Eutrice. And
hello
to the Leid Stories community today.
I
wanted to share something that I stumbled upon last week that might offer some history and context to what's going on in Florida today with regard to voting. I went to the Schomburg Library last weekend for an open house, and I went just, it's an enormous resource that I don't always take advantage of, and my, you know, searching skills are somewhat limited, so I went to attend a workshop on how to use the Schomburg Center. So this is a part of the New York Library system, but they also, for visitors that come, they will give you a 90-day temporary card. So I met Paul Robeson's niece, who was there doing some research for the Robeson House in Philadelphia. So it's a very open center that anyone can come to research. But by coincidence, the librarian used as an example Zora Neale Hurston. And so she went through the process. It was a 30-minute lecture on how to come and do research. Near the end, she explained how even though you're researching one particular person, you can combine, you can ask for additional information, and that they not only have the catalogs that have been entrusted to the Schomburg, but they have the NAACP archives as well. So I hung around after the lecture was over because the search that she had done was still on the computer. So I took a look at the database, And in the NAACP data was a collection of letters. There had been an incident there in the 1949 with an election, and there are many letters to Thurgood Marshall, but there was a very short one that I thought might be interesting to share with our audience, especially those of you who are in Florida and anyone as well. But it has to do with an election that was held in October of 1949. And if it's okay, I'd like to read it. It's very short.
Sure.
It's to Thurgood Marshall, and it says, "Dear Mr. Marshall, we are having a city election here, Tuesday, October 3rd, in which the city officials claim it is a white primary and will not allow the colored people to vote. Being a union leader, it hurts me to see anyone kicked around, and I don't like it. It hurts, in fact, because I have been a poor working white man all my life. I have been kicked around plenty, which was one of the reasons I went into union work. And to hear these so-called big shots damn everyone as a communist who speaks on the laboring speaks for the laboring people really gets under my skin. I feel if colored people could vote Tuesday, it would change the results of the election by defeating the two who are up for re-election. And they certainly need defeating. They are against Senator Pepper and anyone who works for a living. One fellow running told me he had taken it up to the FBI and was told there was nothing that could be done, for which I cannot understand, because it seems to me if the government can step in on state affairs, why can't they step in on a little city government and force them to allow every citizen the right to vote? I started to call you, but I was afraid the local telephone operators might listen in, which they do here sometimes, and then talk about it. And the Western Union telegrams are handled by too many operators on account of being relayed through Tampa. So I decided to write and explain more fully and send it to you by airmail. Please look into this and handle it and force them to allow the colored people the right to vote next Tuesday, if at all possible." And it's signed by the general chairman of the Railroad Telegraphers. So I thought that was very interesting. I mean, there are many letters to him, but that was a relatively short one. But I thought it offered some context to the history of Florida and to what they're going through now.
Absolutely, it does. Quite very much so. Thank you so much. That was quite a contribution. I'm glad that you were able to get to know the Schomburg Library. To me, it is a sad thing that it is, to my view, because every time I've been there and I've been to the Schomburg, I've lost count. It doesn't seem to have the traffic that it ought to have. And it's right there in the community, and people are not taking advantage. They're not making use of this incredible institution. And I wish there would be more interest and greater use of the Schomburg, which is revered by researchers around the world as a repository of information relating to Africans all over the world. So thank you for that. Thanks, Julie. Harvey from Berkeley, you're on the air.
Hello, wonderful Eucheese.
Hey, wonderful Harvey.
Well, here
you're going through a rough time, I see.
Yes, here in Berkeley, the air is unbreathable due to California's toxic forest fires. Schools are canceled today, and we, the public, are being told to stay indoors. And because I believe that the burning of fossil fuels is the main driver behind climate destabilization, I'd like to share some thoughts about the true cost of a gallon of gasoline. And according to the American Automotive Association, the national average for a gallon of gasoline is somewhere around $2.73 per gallon. And that's what we're paying out of our pockets at the pump. But if we include the additional costs that we're paying for climate disasters with our tax dollars and higher insurance rates, I estimate the true cost of a gallon of gasoline to be somewhere around $10 to $12 a gallon. And here are some examples of what I mean. It turns out that defending oil supplies, including everything from guarding shipping lanes to maintaining troop commitments in key oil-producing nations, costs our military more than $81 billion in 2017. That's $81 billion that comes out of our tax dollars to protect the oil companies, plus the cost of climate catastrophes in 2017, including three devastating hurricanes, extreme wildfires, hail, flooding, tornadoes, and drought due to our extensive use, due to our extensive burning of fossil fuels, was around $306 billion, according to the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. Once again, we, the taxpayers, are footing the bill for these climate catastrophes with our tax dollars, personal losses, and higher insurance rates. But there is good news. It turns out that the payback on a solar electric rooftop insulation takes about 8 to 10 years. But if you buy an electric car and plug it into your solar electric rooftop for recharging, the money that you save on gasoline can be put towards accelerating the payback on your solar electric rooftop, reducing the payback time to down to 4 to 5 years. And once you own your own solar panels, you can power your house and your electric vehicle for virtually free for the next 15 or more years, because most solar installations have a lifetime warranty of at least 20 to 25 years. And you can, we can kiss the gasoline pump goodbye, save a ton of money, and all this while helping cool Mother Earth's fever. So, since our lives, the lives of our children and future generations are on the line, it's time to get over our fossil fuel addiction. And I say, let's get star powered. It's time to get solar.
Thank you. In the meantime, how are you viewing the fires in California?
Well, they're horrendous. They're horrendous, and they're, you know, due to climate destabilization and the hotter, you know, it's been every year it's hotter and hotter. The forests have dried out. There's a severe drought happening, and so we're getting these fire tornadoes are called, that just hit an area and devastated. You can't escape. You can't run away. It's just like a fire holocaust. And it's just going to get worse in the coming years. You know, our military, you know, we have to look at what we spend money on now. And we give such a large budget to the military-industrial complex. They have over 100 facilities worldwide, 100 bases worldwide, over 100, I should say, hundreds of bases worldwide. And they're all there to protect America. Meanwhile, California is burning. You know, we have severe droughts, unbelievable hurricanes and flooding. The real enemy now is climate change, and the fossil fuel industry is the main culprit behind all this. And meanwhile, we have an administration, the Trump administration, that are a wholly owned subsidiary of the fossil fuel industry, rather than leading us toward a safer, better life. They're actually leading us into the jaws of death. I'm talking about death, because here in California there's hundreds missing around paradise. You know, like they say, mm-hmm. paradise is burning, and they're going to put up a parking lot. It's just a terrible thing happening here. And you know, I won't even go outside today because the air is so toxic to breathe. It's never been this bad, not as far as I remember. So that's what's happening. We have to rethink our allocations of our tax dollars and save America first before I can't imagine how many service men and women are out there in foreign bases that are from California that would love to be back here helping to fight the forest fires. Meanwhile, there's countries like Australia and other countries are sending people to help fight the forest fires, and forest firefighters are coming in from other states to help California. Why is this? We have so much equipment around the world that military equipment alone that could help put out these fires, but it's being used to protect the oil industry as they secure their grip on the world. So we really have to rethink what we do with our tax dollars, because California is on fire right now, and we need to be saved, not from the outside enemy, but from the fossil fuel industry.
Thank you very much, Harvey. Always something to think about from you. Thank you. Thanks for your call. Ed from Queens, you're on the air.
Hello. Hello, Utrice.
Hello.
How you doing?
Hello.
Hello, Utrice. Hello. How you doing?
I'm okay. How about you?
I'm still here. I'm going to bring it back to a local concern. I understand about the forest fires, and believe me, I know that global warming is a problem. But I'm a native New Yorker, and last night I had to spend 5 hours sitting on the Interboro Parkway because of this storm that was underrated by the media and by the local government. And this is not the first time this has happened. And I'm beginning to believe that we're getting weaker and weaker in the city as far as when it comes to responding to these major events. I mean, you know, the forecasting predicted it was going to be a light snow that was going to disappear by the time just after the rush hour. We turned out to have 6 inches, which is not that bad for someone who's lived in New York. 6 inches is not that bad, but the response, the lack of, I didn't see a plow all night. I didn't see a salt spreader all night. And it was supposed to have been set up, and everybody was supposed to be ready for this major weather event in early November. And it was just ridiculous to sit on the ground, my commute normally takes less than 30 minutes. And I sat on Jackie Robinson Parkway for 4 hours. I had to stop the car because it wasn't parking lot. And I'm not the only one that has happened to. And my second point, they want to raise the transit fare. They want to raise because they say there's a lack of ridership. Just from empirical knowledge, I've never seen an uncrowded train. I mean, sometimes the E train that comes out of 23rd Street, you got to wait 2 and 3 trips before you can even get on it. So I don't know where this lack of ridership or lack of revenue is coming from. I remember years ago, the Transit Authority was found to have 2 books. I don't know if anybody remembers that, but it was a few years back when the Transit Authority had 2 sets of books to record revenue. I think we should take another look at that again before they start raising fares and talking about lower ridership, because I don't see it as a personally as a commuter. And these response to these minor weather incidents, they don't compare to back in the days. I remember blizzards in New York where we still kept on rolling. I remember rainstorms and severe weather where we still kept on rolling. And for a little 6 inches of snow to stop with everything like it did last night, totally ridiculous.
All right. Well, you're right. That's a local issue, and I hope more people are feeling like you and are inclined to become involved in doing something about it. Thanks so much, Ed. From
Thank you.
Atlanta, Yolanda from Atlanta, you're on the air.
How are you?
All righty. Thank you. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks. I'm kind of a little, I'm not upset usually, but when I see people like Avi keep on mentioning climate change, when we are dealing with climate engineering, they are engineering the weather. Right now, I'm in Atlanta. I'm looking at the sky, and I'm seeing these airplanes with no sign on them, unmarked airplanes, spraying the sky. They are putting a blanket in the sky every single day all over the U.S. right now. And we are sleeping at the wheel thinking, oh, it's climate change, it's fossil fuel, when it's not. They are engineering the weather. For the past 2 years, when we see the once in a lifetime, everything is, the first time we ever seen such a hurricane. When Michio Kaku went on CBS and ABC saying the government has the technology to manipulate the weather, they've been doing it since 1943. Right now, what's going on in Paradise, California, is nothing but it's engineered. And if you look at these houses are melted down. It's called direct energy. And if you listen to Global Alert News, that is right after your show on Wednesday on PRN with Dane Wigginton, people should look at that show every Wednesday after your show, 1 to 2. This guy is number one in the United States as giving reliable information about what's going on with the weather. He has CIA agents. He has NASA whistleblowers all team up with him to educate the people, to create awareness on what's going on in the world. Right now, the government can target your house right now. If you are a progressive person making a difference, making an impact on the internet. They can just use direct energy and burn your house down. I mean, 600 people are unaccounted for. 63 are dead in California. Many years ago, you could just see people running with their pajamas, you know, away from a fire. Right now, these people are just dead in their house. They could, their bone become like charcoal. Okay, you never see anything like this before. What they're doing, they're changing society. They're doing mass migration. They're pushing people around. Like Gary always said, they are about to create blue zone, yellow zone. They're changing. They're pushing people forcefully. And I hope you could, I hope you could listen to that geoengineering global alert news on PRN.
Yes.
And he has like 3,000 articles. Scientific article in his website, geoengineeringwatch.org, and it's a wealth of information. He has interviewed with every, you know, doctor, Ken Penny, Dr. Susan Humphrey, every with CIA agent, and everyone, every scientist, credible scientist, showing the proof that they are having a warfare on the American people. Right now, we are dying of lung cancer, of Alzheimer, Parkinson. You know, that place called Mexico Beach in Florida that had that hurricane, they leveled that place down because it's a paradise. They need the location. They can't buy people out, so they're forcing you out. That place called Paradise in California, they're pushing Napa Valley, pushing. Everybody's saying, what's going on? But nobody's looking at the real issue, which is geoengineering, climate engineering. Avi, if you are listening to me right now, you better go to geoengineeringwatch.org, and you will get better information than you. You're stuck in one thing, fossil fuel, when it's not the case. It's the government creating the problem that we have right now that is destroying the ecological of the earth. Now we are at the point of no return because they're playing so much with the weather. Now we can, they cannot control it anymore. So that's all I have.
Thank you. That's very good contribution, very useful information. Thank you for sharing it today, Yolanda. Thanks for calling in. We go next to David from Brooklyn.
Good afternoon, you Trace.
Hello, David. How are you?
A pleasure to talk with you today. I don't know if you got the email I sent off to you about the possibility of Lead Stories get together in New York City next April or May.
I haven't read my email, so I definitely will check it now.
yes, because I'm willing to help on that, and maybe we'll have even a bigger group than we had last year. So that's something I have in mind. What I'd like to talk about today is this. You spoke about the lottery and this fellow here in Harlem who got the big prize. And it was mentioned that most of his money is going to go for taxes. And I think that's important for people to get into their head, that the fact that all over the country you have these lotteries and you have gambling casinos and so forth is, very important for people to know. The reason that we have all this type of thing is that because the people who should be paying the taxes, the big corporations and the richest people, don't have to pay. If you can get poorer people to go to these gambling casinos and throw away their money. And that's a very serious matter. We've got too many lotteries and gambling casinos all over. And the rich and powerful and the oligarchs can pay less in taxes and they can get reductions like the Trump tax cuts and so forth. And the poor folks are supposed to go to the gambling casino and lose their money, and that money can be taxed and, instead of taxing people who should be taxed more. That's one item. The other thing that comes to mind, I was on Monday, and when you talked about veterans, and it made me think of this. When you look at the press, the corporate press, they hardly ever, ever talk about the good policies, social and economic policies that other developed countries have for the benefit of their citizens. That's pretty well left out. They don't tell you how veterans are treated in other countries, even countries that were defeated in the Second World War, like Japan and Germany and what. What kind of benefits do their veterans get? And also, a big part of this thing that I'm thinking about is we know very little about the type of social and economic benefits that people have in countries through Western Europe, Northwestern Europe, the Scandinavian countries, Japan and Taiwan and people like that, and countries like that. So it's important to get this information out. But the ruling class, I believe, doesn't want people to have that information. They don't want to tell you how good people have it in Norway or what can be done by a government that doesn't spend all this money buying fighter planes and tanks and military equipment and intelligence services. They don't want you to know that. So I think that's something that really needs to be done to improve what people can get in terms of information. And maybe I don't know, it'd be kind of hard to lean on corporate media because they don't want to spread this information around. But this is what I think is important for people to know about.
Thank you. And you'll hear from me. You gave me incentive to go check my email now. Thanks, David, for your call. Okay, we have one more call to go, and it will be Ma'at from New York.
Yes, greetings to the beloved family. Boy, we're having a cold snap in New York, and it's somewhat of a struggle to stay warm. But first I want to share, and this is also directed to Ali, because I know I was equivocating the Friday before the voting, not being a spring chicken, I needed to put some logistics in place, which I did Friday night, and I made it to vote, and had voted for Bernie in the primary, but didn't vote in the general, so I put it together, and I even voted for Howie Hawkins over Cuomo. I guess you could say that was a protest vote. But it was so wonderful to hear that sister, I think her name was Yvette, around the geoengineering. I used to love to hear her. And she hadn't called in a while, so that was so wonderful. And, you know, the caller yesterday mentioned about how the trees look so different than the houses, and the way the houses are totally destroyed. Plus, I heard reports on the news that the bones, that people didn't even have bones now. In order to get those bones, you need a crematorium at very unusual, I think it's over 2,000 degrees or so. So, yes, there is something that is going on there. So I hope, what's that, Utrice?
Yes, I'm listening.
Yes, I hope that she'll continue to connect with us. And I'd also like you to maybe once a month to, obviously we have, our family is I'm sure, are people who read. So maybe once a month, you could put aside a day where we could be prepared to talk about what we're reading. I think that would be something really interesting with this family. But I just want to do a quick update around the latest thing from the thug in the White House. It seems that regarding the Khashoggi situation, they've come up with, I'm sure everyone's heard about the, I think, was he a cleric? He lives in the Poconos. Flynn, the former national security advisor who pleaded guilty to lying to the feds, was trying to literally kidnap the guy. So, in other words, the current plan is, and they're looking into appeasing Turkey, because Turkey is the one that's sort of, curiously, speaking up for, you know, more accountability and justice. So they're trying to figure out if they can. The guy's been living in this country for 20 years or so, but they're looking to appease Turkey and to tamp down what Turkey is asking for as to accountability by figuring out some way to ship off, you know, who Erdogan wants to blame for being part of that coup some years ago. So that's some more torture and killing. So, and the last point I want to make is about the fires. First of all, you notice that Trump is so self-concerned and so narcissistic. In order to find a solution to things, you first have to have some empathy, right? You know, as opposed to his greed, blaming the Forest Service, not even, of course, knowing what he's talking about. But you start with empathy. He's not expressing any concern and you know, just care and uplift and compassion and message to what those people are experiencing. So I would say that with everything else and being it part of an overall plan, that's part of the problem to a real solution.
Well, thank you for your contribution, and thank you for closing us out today. This brings us to the end of our Free Your Mind Friday segment. I really love it because people get to express themselves in a non-scripted way about the things that they deem to be important. And it is, as you can tell, it's a wide range of opinions, but you get a sense of what is grabbing people's attention. Despite all the things that we talk about, these are the things that are grabbing people's attention. I think of, from Queens, we had a brother from Queens, Ed from Queens, talking about, you know, spending 4 hours on the Interborough. And he's talking about the state of affairs with transportation systems in New York. That the contention by the city that they need to revamp and rethink their transportation systems, suggesting that they're being underused. You know, it's a very incredible observation he has made. And it's just from his own everyday life experience. So that, to me, is a very valuable indication that people are paying attention to how they are being forced by an entity that they don't directly control. But there are plans just the same being made to that would affect your life. Why should a person have to sit on a highway for 4 hours? You know, why should people now be prepared? Because that's really the story. They're preparing people for a whole different transportation system. Of course, it's going to cost more, but this is the brilliant idea. The idea is that the transportation systems should not be for regular, ordinary people. The ordinary people should foot the bill, but the benefit of a smooth working transportation system should be for the people who are deemed to be more important. These are incredible indications that people are observing and understanding the realities that they live every single day. And the people who are running things just can't seem to do that. They just can't seem to connect it. Coming back to the fires, it's a major, major tragedy. Any nation would be a national mourning over it, but not this nation and not with this president. Thanks so much for being with me today and for contributing. Have yourselves a great weekend. Surround yourselves with positive people, and we'll see each other Monday. Bye-bye.